is going to talk to us about the Eucharist.
Thank you. I'm
going to do it. You're going to do it.
And thanks for putting my yourself on. I appreciate it. There was one woman under the table the whole time. I think she was recording me, though. I think she was taking notes, but she couldn't put it down for half an hour. So I appreciate it. Okay, that's my name, Paula Vercollone. I come from Pembroke. Oh, wait. Stop. Prayer, most important thing. Remember that video?
Okay, let's not start.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of us, all your faithful here, and kindle in us the fire of your love. Help us to be open-minded. Help us to have a growth mindset for this subject and for all that you want to teach us. Help us to listen with our hearts and our minds so that we can become closer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, through the Eucharist. And we pray through the Blessed Mother and through our Lord. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Kathleen, I'll make sure I only take a half an hour or less, so you have enough time.
Okay.
Last time you were rushed, and that was not okay. So, I'm Paula from Pembroke. Why am I here from Pembroke? Because I think you guys are awesome. I'm serious. And this program is the best. When I heard that St. Joseph's was doing this program, Family Faith Formation, am I saying that right? I said, I want to help. Because I help at St. Nicholas a little tiny bit. Because I don't like their program. Isn't that terrible? We pass our faith on through the parents. You know the home is like a little church. It's very holy. And meal times to be almost like going to church. It's like an altar. Well, the table, the altar is like a table. Family meal times are so crucial. So family faith formation. There's just no other way. And even with doing our best, modeling the faith for the children, they still have to accept it themselves. And that's really hard as a parent to watch them not accept it. But then again, we have to think of ourselves and the times when we didn't accept it or when we don't. And God is patient with us, so we have to be patient with our kids. And that's easy for me to say because, well, I'll confess, I have 11 kids and they don't all go to church. It was hard when they stopped dropping. And, some of them still don't. But one just came back. Oh my gosh, it was so awesome. I hope he stays. He's only 25, but he went to Providence College, and during college, which we thought a Catholic school might keep him there, but he just kind of dwindled along. And till he finally didn't go anymore. I'll never forget the first Easter. He didn't come with all of us. He stayed home. We got back. We had a family breakfast. I said, so what did you do while we were gone? He goes, tried to watch TV, but nothing was on except for church. I was like, oh, dang. But, it's really hard. And it hurts. But speaking about family mealtimes, I would like to suggest and encourage you all to have at least one family meal a week. I'm not saying which day, but at least one, two or three would be better. Nothing fancy. We had soup and sandwich tonight, but and pray a blessing for the meals, because those times are just so important for the kids. And we even have this little prayer that we got at the this one year. Maybe it was this church. It was just a prayer I copied it. And then afterwards we say to the kids, do you have anybody sick you want to pray for? You would be surprised when you find out. Oh yeah, my coach's daughter. Oh yeah, my friend's grandmother. Oh yeah, my this. If I had offered that the other night, I wouldn't know that my son's track coach's daughter got in a snowmobile accident. Well, they don't just tell you these things. So I'm very lucky. And feel free, if you have any questions, did. I have great and perfect kids. No, they are great kids. Okay, so when Kathleen asked me to talk about the Eucharist, and I told my husband, you know, how they always have an opinion like we do, and he said, well, that's funny you talk about the Eucharist. Why don't you tell them about how you didn't believe?
That would be interesting. I bet they like that.
So before we got married, I'm not a confirmed Catholic. I had been baptized in First Holy Communion, and my mother and father got a divorce. And my mother took us out of the Catholic Church. And we tried all different kinds of religions. And we ended up Baptist. And she raised us anti-Catholic. Which was, I thought it was normal. Everyone hates the Catholic Church. And so then when I was dating my husband, who was Catholic and would not practice any other religion, even though he was a boyfriend and went to my parents' church, and I was like, yes, he's going to be saved. Taken away from that other church. I said, no, if we're going to continue to date, and if we're going to get married, then it has to be the Catholic Church. And I was 21 years old, 22 maybe at the time. I said, oh, yeah, sure, I'm here. And I didn't care. Until we got married, and then we had to pick a church. Dude, you have to go to that church, your church, up there, that ugly old brick church. Yeah, it was the other one. That's our church. Okay, so after being very, I don't know what the word is, stubborn, bitter, angry, going to Mass for several months, I'm like, I need an attitude. This is not going well. So I said, I need to learn more about this religion of yours. I don't understand what they're doing. I don't understand the priest's messages. I don't agree with them. I would walk out many times. Most Catholics don't walk out of church, right? See them in the parking lot pacing. But anyway, so I decided to go through the confirmation program. And at that point, I was 9 months pregnant. That was very embarrassing. But I said to my husband, I can't be confirmed because I don't believe in the Eucharist. And I know that's one of your beliefs. And he said, don't worry. Most Catholics don't believe. Just join the group. Okay. I joined. I got confirmed. And I went up Sunday after Sunday and received the Eucharist. Not believing. Not caring if I believed. Not wanting to believe. No question. Oh, why didn't you believe? Because I thought it was ridiculous. How could that happen? How could God be in that bread and in that body? That's an excellent question. It's just too impossible for my mind to understand, so therefore, it couldn't happen. My simple mind couldn't get it. Well, so years went by. I'm 63 right now. We've been married for 40 years. So years went by, tick, 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 tick. And at some point, maybe 10 years later, I was asked to be a Eucharistic minister, just suddenly, like just snapped out of the congregation. Here, we need somebody to give out Holy Communion. It might have been like a cursio event or something, you know, just a small group. Oh, okay, sure. Plunged up there, saying the body of Christ over and over again, not believing. It gets you thinking, how can I say that? So then I started to think, maybe I'd like to believe. God, help me believe this. That was my prayer. Nothing fancy. Help me. I don't get this. Can you help me believe this body of Christ? And then, sometime later, in 2004, about 15 years ago now, Pope St. John Paul II had a year of the Eucharist. That's 15 years ago. So many of you weren't born yet. 15 years ago, the year of the Eucharist. And I was so excited. Oh, I'm going to start the letter on the Eucharist. And he wrote some letters on it. And I read them all. But one of them that was so beautiful called Stay With Us, Lord. And it was just about that, staying with us. How God loves us, present tense, so much, that not only did he send his only son to save us, and he sent him as a little baby, which is so beautiful at this time of year, Christmas, to keep remembering Christmas and looking at the cute little innocent baby, born in a poor, stinky manger. But then he died. And he's staying with us. Staying with us because he loves us so much and he knows we need strength for the journey of life. We need supernatural strength. I like to call it superpower strength. The power heroes that all the kids are into now, superheroes. We have a superhero. Jesus. Oh, he's a real superhero, not a cartoon superhero. And he gives us super strength. We call it grace. But I don't know about you, but I really need it. I super need it. And that's what happened. I prayed, and John Paul II wrote that just for me, so I could read about the Eucharist. And then I still didn't believe exactly, but I wanted to believe more and more. So it was like, Lord, I want to believe. Help me. And then I got to do this class. Before this class, it's just studying and learning in our head and being open, I think. That's why at the beginning when I prayed to the Holy Spirit that we would be open to this topic, be open to the topic, because just because we don't understand something doesn't mean it isn't true. That was my point. I didn't understand transubstantiation, which is a fancy, fancy word that the church invented to try to explain the substance of the bread and the substance of the wine is changed to be the actual body and blood of Jesus. Now you say, what does that mean, substance? Actually, it's a metaphysical term. And I use the word metaphysics because I have studied a little bit of metaphysics. Metaphysics is some kind of philosophy. And it's the study of being. Like we are. This is my body. You can touch, smell me, maybe, probably. Okay, we have, we're physical. But we are made up of a substance. That's our soul. So the bread doesn't have a soul, but it has a substance. It's very difficult to understand, to explain it. I can't explain it. A metaphysicist can explain it. And even then, good luck to you. But to me, it's like someone trying to explain Google to me, or the World Wide Web, or tweeting. I don't get it. It just happens. We tweet and it goes, says, this is my body, this is my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. And when he says it, it happens. Now, for instance, have you ever heard of Bishop Barron? Bishop Robert Barron, some of you? Bishop Robert Barron. So he gave a talk on the Eucharist, which I have not heard. But your great Father Jack, who's here, after hearing my talk, he told me, go listen to Bishop Banner on the Eucharist. Guys, if you want to learn about anything in our faith that you like or dislike, go to Bishop Banner, YouTube, Google him. Oh, he's very entertaining and intellectual. He'll challenge you, but it's not too hard to understand. So Bishop Banner was to explain the Eucharist. He said, the Eucharist is the Word. This is the Word, right? We've all known this. This is the Word. And in the chapter of John, which is in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the first words in John are, I have to
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I know you've all heard this, because I have too. How many times? I'm having a whole lot. Okay, so I've heard this at least 70 times. But I didn't get it in reference to the Eucharist. So Jesus is the Word. God is the Word. Jesus is the Word. What he says happens. That's easy, right? What he says happens. You're blind, see, the person sees. You can't walk, walk, the person walks. I want this bread to be my body. This is my body. It is, because he said it. That's not the easiest explanation I've ever heard. That was only a couple days ago. Thank you very much, Father Jack. He was great. It was so simple. So, when Jesus tells all his friends and all his disciples in this chapter, he was somewhere, I don't know, Galilee or something, but it's in John chapter 6. It's called the Bread of Life Discourse, and he's trying to tell them that he is the bread of life. You have to eat this bread, drink this bread, have life forever, have eternal life. Most of them walk away. They leave. I don't know if you remember that. Doesn't stop and say, come back, I was just kidding. This is just a symbol, I really didn't mean it. He doesn't. He lets them know. And that's another thing he'll do for us. He won't force us to love him. He won't force us to believe in him. He loves us so much he gives us freedom. Freedom to choose him. So what do we choose? Choose to believe or choose to want to believe, or I want to believe, help me believe. So when you have time, read John chapter 6 and how he is the bread of life. Because he said, and unfortunately coming from the Protestant background, that takes the Bible so literally. Everything is literal. All the Old Testament, all the New Testament, every single word is literal. What happens in John chapter 6? They don't read it. They must skip over it because it's very literal. So, I want to help you learn about transubstantiation and when it happens in the Mass. So that's why we have these blue books. Can everyone take one?
Your church is
attention, not to the brotherless thing, but we'll go over real quick, and you can see exactly where the epiclesis is, and then where the consecration is. Okay? So, the first Eucharistic prayer on page 14, that's the longest Eucharistic prayer in the priest. Usually, well, you see there are these other Eucharistic prayers, reconciliation 1, reconciliation 2. Yes, those are occasionally used. But the four main ones, Eucharistic prayer number 1, page 14, which the longest one takes about 3 minutes longer than the others. So most priests don't use it because they get complaints from the congregation. I used to think that the epiclesis was right at the beginning where they have that little cross down in the fifth line where the priest says, therefore, most merciful Father, make humble prayer petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings. It's not that.
I was informed.
So turn the page. Page 16 is the same Eucharistic prayer. The epiclesis is on the left, up top, no cross in the middle of it. It says, be pleased, O God, we pray, as all of us, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of the most beloved Son, our Lord. So that's the calling down, the prayer. Now, the consecration is the same in all the Eucharistic prayers. The capital letters, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body. And sometimes priests will say those words very, very slowly because they're so special. And they're repeating Jesus' words at the Last Supper, the first consecration. And then, of course, with the wine, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. That's the consecration. That's when the wine becomes the blood of Christ. Now, again, both with the bread and the wine, the accidents don't change. The physical, the smell, the sight, the taste, they taste like bread. They taste like wine. It's the substance that changes. It's a miracle. It's a mystery because we can't explain it so perfectly. We try to explain it with the transubstantiation. If we